Professor Dave here. Let's talk about the double-slit experiment.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
In learning about the first few discoveries that led to the development of quantum mechanics, we discussed wave-particle duality. So we understand that both light and matter behave as both particles and waves. But we glossed over some of the technical details, so let's zoom in for a moment. In 1801, Thomas Young performed experiments where light was passed through a plane with two slits in it, striking a screen beyond. The diffraction and interference patterns that resulted clearly supported the wave model of light, with the brighter bands representing constructive interference and the darker bands representing destructive interference, with the width of the bands being a function of the frequency of the light. Later in the century, Maxwell showed that light is a wave of oscillating electric and magnetic fields, so it seemed as though the case was closed on the declaration of light as waves. But as we said, in 1905, Einstein solved the problem of the photoelectric effect by assigning particle nature to light. Thus, wave-particle duality was born. Later, Debroglie proposed that particles must therefore also display wave-like behavior, and this was shown to be true in an experiment, just like Young's more than 100 years prior. This modern version is what we are typically referring to when we talk about the double-slit experiment. From this, it was shown that a beam of electrons exhibits diffraction and interference patterns, just like light does. This demonstrates the wave-like properties of electrons, and by extension, matter in general. Later, low-intensity experiments showed that even an individual electron, when passing through biprisms or slits, will interfere with itself, making the wave-like nature of the electron undeniable. So it was shown that electrons act as both particles and waves, but not just electrons. Neutrons were also shown to exhibit diffraction patterns. It must be understood that since all particles are also waves, literally any object could hypothetically exhibit a diffraction pattern, so long as the object passes through an aperture roughly the size of the object's wavelength. But remember that massive objects have incredibly tiny wavelengths. So for something like a human being to diffract, they would have to pass through an aperture around 10 to the negative 36 meters wide, which is a trillionth of a trillionth of a trillionth of a meter. So this will be pretty tough, no matter how much you diet. In this way, we begin to see how Newtonian mechanics is not the fundamental descriptor of motion, but rather that it emerges from quantum mechanics as objects become large enough that their wavelengths are negligible. So don't worry, everything you learned in classical physics will still work just fine for any object you can see with your eyes. But along with these waves of matter came the wave function and the quest to describe it mathematically. This would be impossible without the creation of quantum mechanics, which was achieved by a host of brilliant minds. But we will focus on two people in particular, Erwin Schrödinger and Werner Heisenberg. Let's move forward and see what they had to say on the subject. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials, support me on Patreon so I can keep making content, and as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.